Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of you here today on the seventh Sunday of Easter, but we are going to observe Ascension Day up through endless ranks of angels, we will see later on. I think it's important that we do this. Ascension Day is actually on Thursday. It's 40 days after Easter. It's always on Thursday, but there's so much important stuff that happens that's for our benefit that we often don't hear it because we don't have a tradition of a Thursday Ascension Day service. So we'll do that today. Let's see. I don't have any announcements. Otherwise, it seems like a kind of ordinary spring day. Kind of low cloudy setting one is printed in full in your bulletin, page one. Let's remember our baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have our nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you.
9-11. In the first book of the Apocalypse, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach, until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. To them he presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The bread Christ has risen from the dead. God the Father has crowned him with glory and honor. He has given him dominion over the works of his hands. He has put all things under his feet.
The epistle reading is taken from Ephesians 1:15-23. "For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise. We follow the verse.
Hallelujah. We know that Christ being raised from the dead will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over us. Hallelujah. Behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them interesting, whenever he spoke, he looked up into the sky, utterly disconnected from his hearers, which for a six-year-old boy was utterly boring. I'd rather be climbing my favorite pine tree down by the creek bottom than watching this movie. I remember tuning back in somewhere along the lines where Jesus met Zacchaeus. Jesus was laughing at him because Zacchaeus couldn't read something that was on a shelf in his house. You know, Zacchaeus was a wee little man. Why would Zacchaeus put something in his own house out of his reach? Anyway, it was a terrible movie, and it ended with Jesus like this. Jesus is with his apostles on the mountaintop. Now, at least they got that part right. And that's an important detail for later on, so mark it down. It'll be on the quiz. Jesus is on a mountaintop. He blesses them and starts floating away. The camera switches in from looking at Jesus to looking from Jesus' point of view. And you see the apostles getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and the cloud comes and hides, and you can't see them anymore. And Jesus apparently is filled with helium because he keeps going up and up and up, and he's still talking, and lo, I am with you until the very end of the age, still floating past some satellites. Even at 6 years old, dreaming of my beloved pine tree, I was thinking, how is Jesus breathing? He's in outer space, and outer space is really big. How far away is he going to go? How is he always with us and still so far away? That's a child's question, right? And notice that those are child's questions. Consider the apostles' question. Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? That's not at all a child's question. You'll also notice that Jesus doesn't correct the question. He doesn't yell at them for not getting it like he has in the past. So apparently, he had told them somewhere along in his ministry, probably after the resurrection, that he, Jesus, was going to restore the kingdom to Israel. Now we'll get back to that in a minute or two. But first, let's go to the end. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, so again, they are eyewitnesses of these things. He actually calls them that. You are witnesses. They are eyewitnesses of these things, the apostles are. They watch him go, the 11 of them do. As they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. He was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. So in your own mind, about how far up was he lifted? So like, you know, about that far? Or is it like, in your mind, he just kind of kept floating away like a helium balloon? The six-year-old boy owner is distracted by visions of his pine tree, accidentally let go, and is now floating away, and the little boy's crying. You know they were on a mountaintop. I mean, it's right there, mountaintop. It doesn't really have to be a high mountaintop to find some clouds. I mean, you can go to the Niagara Escarpment, which is actually below here. Just about any time of year, you can see clouds come up and scoot over. Mount Hermon in Israel, for example, is 7,000 feet. Now, that's not near Jerusalem. But near Jerusalem, you have the hills and mountains that peak at 2,500 feet. That's the same elevation as the Allegheny State Park. So he was lifted up about that far, is utterly hidden from us. They came from the kingdom. You know the place. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Truly I say to you, you will be with me today in paradise. The kingdom. The kingdom which has no beginning and no end. The kingdom which is not seen, but is all around. The kingdom which is cast in weakness, but it reigns supreme. Jesus went to his kingdom where he rules the world according to his wisdom, like Solomon, except bigger and better and everlasting. You know, I tried to think of an awful lesson to illustrate, especially at the 8:15 church service, what it means to have an everlasting kingdom in our ever-changing and ever-decaying world. And the best I could come up with was an airbag cartridge. You know, the things in the car that make the airbag The affordable ones, I looked it up because I was going to get some. The affordable ones are made for horse riding vests. Say, they work the same way as the ones in your car. The right amount of force, say, falling off a horse and getting to the ground, right? An electrical current, some combustion, the cartridge breaks open, and then faster than your body can actually make contact with the ground, poof, nitrogen gas fills the bag, creating a safety. Great visual effect, I thought. But they're $50 a pop. And I have to practice with one at least once, so I'm $50 there. And it didn't go quite right. I have to practice again to work out the bugs. That's another $50. And then I have to do one for this service and then one for the late service. So that's $150 to $200 just for a, you know, a hokey object lesson. And besides which, I'm not sure it even makes any sense. Jesus filled the earth with his presence. See? I don't know. Does it work? Nitrogen gas. I don't think Jesus is nitrogen gas. That doesn't work right. Anyway, how does an airbag convey that? Doesn't. And I was also afraid, too, that because there's combustion involved, that somebody might get hurt. Most likely me. So I thought, no, that's not too bad. Don't want to make the news. So how do I convey the truth? That in the ascension, Jesus assumed the entire world into himself. Now I thought about it long and hard, no kidding. And suddenly it hit me. Maybe just stick to the word pictures that Jesus gives us. I am the vine, he says. You are the branches. Where is the kingdom of God? Wherever you are. Where does Jesus exercise his authority? Wherever you are. What authority is that? Well, it's the authority to forgive sins. The authority to forgive sins is your authority. When, how does that authority get exercised? Whenever you forgive sins and give new life. Because whenever you forgive sins, you're actually giving new life. And you're giving new life because Jesus is the vine. He abides in you. You are the branches. You abide in him. There's the kingdom that you're looking for. You know, I was saying at communion, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Yeah, that's you. That's the ascension of our Lord at work in you. Whenever you do good, you indeed glorify the Father. You demonstrate that the kingdom is coming in you. Because as you know, when we pray, thy kingdom come. We're not praying for some magical manifestation of the kingdom, but that we have the kingdom come to us in our good works in the world here, now, and in life everlasting. So, God took the kingdom away from Israel. At the moment of the ascension, the apostles are asking him, Lord, and notice they call him Lord. All the words today are about power and authority, aren't they? The epistle lesson describes the ascended Lord like this. It comments on the ascension. And seated him at God's right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and he put all things under his feet and gave them to the church ascension, we get the answer to that, don't we? So join us again next week. Same time, same place, and we will see the kingdom restored to Israel, albeit in an unexpected way, even though it is certainly according to the promises of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For resurrection appeared openly to all his disciples, and in their sight was taken up into heaven, that he might make us partakers of his divine life. Therefore, with angels and